session on reimagining customer experience in logistics. We would like to begin by thanking you all for being a part of the Logistics Tech Conference. Without further ado, it's my pleasure to introduce you to the esteemed panelists, Mr. K.T. Prasad, MD and RVP, Sales India and SAARC, Zendesk, who will be moderating this session. Continuing, Mr. Vaibhav Khandelwal, co-founder and CTO, Shadowfax Technologies, Ms. Sonia Radhakrishnan Nair, National Head Customer Service, Blue Dart, Ms. Neha Parekh, Head Logistics and Customer Service, Godrej Consumer Products, and Mr. Supil Chachan, Senior Director, Freight Business, BlackBuck. Over to you, Mr. Prasad.
Thank you. Thank you very much. A very good morning to all the people who are joining, and good morning to the panel. It's a real pleasure to have such a vibrant and diversified panel to speak about customer experience and in the logistics industry. If I just take a pause and look through last 17, 18 months, I think since the time the pandemic has just started to influence on how some of the businesses would impact and also customers get impacted, things have changed, things have evolved. I think people say the digital transformation happened at the fastest pace that anybody could imagine. And there's also saying that, you know, who brought in a most amount of transformation? Is it a CIO, CDO? And this is the old one, all of you would know, it's COVID who brought in accelerated digital transformation. You know, and business have been impacted, especially logistics played a very, very pivotal role in the last 18 months or so. You know, considering the e-commerce on the rise, the number of digital transactions, I would say, take a pause, not just digital transactions, both from what customers are buying, but the number of payments, UPI transactions, you name it, all went to the top of the charts that we have seen so far. What really gives us, that means, you know, when you have so many customers engaging us digitally, these customers earlier used to be, you know, a community that we all used to be aware, you know, pretty young population, digitally aware, understands, you know, have a digital, great digital literacy. They know how to get things around and they would behave very differently. At the same time, there is a consumers because of the need, because of lockdowns in different states and districts, you know, it also forced most of the consumers to get onto a digital platform and actually created a segment of customers for all of us to handle who are not great with digital, but they're just getting their journey on and they're getting used to it. So all of a sudden, all of us were managing a business where we used to know one segment of customers, you know, we used to deal with them. Now we have two sets of customers with a different digital literacy levels to handle. At the same time, you know, across e-commerce, there's a huge surge of number of transactions that we discussed, and logistics played a very important role. I want to thank you know, all of you being playing the essential you know, services role in the last 16-18 months, and providing us, all of us, not just us, not just me, but also all the people who are joining and across the country, gave us opportunity to stay back home and staying safe and getting what we still need. And like I said, there are two segments of customers, and these two segments of customers' demands and expectations are changing and changing faster. Because nowadays, customers' loyalty can be questioned. You know, is customer willing to pay a premium? Is customer willing to pay for a better service? I think all of these being tested, but one thing which came out very clearly in one of the recent CX Trends report that Zendesk has put across, another, you know, company that I work for, it's very clear that the customer expectations are changing and changing faster, and their customers are more subtle when they use a certain medium of communication with the businesses. That's being number one, being a self-service. Number two being messaging. You know, messaging is basically where you start a customer journey with a simple, you know, interaction on digital presence, and eventually take them to maybe a you know, a chat, maybe, or a call, or doesn't matter, entire conversation that you have. With that, I want to invite all the panelists, and I want to start by, you know, start with Neha. Neha, like I've said, the context, there is so much of change that has happened. And you being part of Godrej, which is providing, you know, consumer products, essential service once again, you know, with there's a rapid growth in e-commerce, D2C, hyper-local deliveries and stuff like that we've seen, right? And which extensively relies on logistics. Has this surge in demand spurred any newer technology innovation developments for logistics sector that you have to deal with?
Thank you, Prashad, and good morning to all my co-panelists and participants. Happy to be part of a very engaging panel. Prashad, on your question, last year has been challenging for the entire supply chain, if I have to say, not just the logistics, but manufacturing. But still, there was a lot of rules that got framed, and even the lockdown rules were very clear on manufacturing, that anything that is continuous. But logistics always remained like a gray area, that which vehicles can go, when can they ply, can primary vehicles ply, can secondary vehicles ply. All of it was very heavily impacted due to this. And so that was on the supply side of it, where we faced a lot of disruption. Other was the availability of vehicles, or the availability of drivers who are willing to go got impacted, because no driver was willing to ply on longer routes because they said that everything is closed on highway. Where will I have my food? Where will I have water and all those things? And hence the whole ecosystem that was there for the transport industry kind of collapsed. In fact, when lockdown happened, I think most of the companies had close to, at least we had 120 trucks stranded on the roads. We did not know where they are because the drivers had to go. A lot of them went without food for 3-4 days because the lockdown was sudden, and then we took a while to come there. But yes, it also led to a lot of things that we realized as business continuity. So, and hence it kind of catalyzed the tech revolutions that we were doing, specifically on logistics space. One prime example is now most of the companies have gone ahead and done track and trace of all their vehicles, either an API based or a SIM based, because that is now becoming more of a necessity. Because if any kind of event happens tomorrow, you should know where your vehicles are. How do you track them? How efficient are they? And it also helps. And it's not just track and trace. You're also imbibing certain things like, is the safe driving practice being followed? Is driver taking breaks in between? Is night driving avoided? All of it. So because this whole well-being part, which also is now being considered, which was practically ignored in the earlier scenario, right? So as logistics, yes, we faced a lot of brunt, but that has made us rethink the way we do logistics in India. And there's a lot of collaborations also that are happening. So every company is now coming forward, making shorter holds, giving the return loads and ensuring that whatever vehicles are there, the capacity has dipped. How do we maximize the utilization of capacities? So as GCPL, that was on the supply side. I'll also briefly take you on the demand side of it. So on demand side, what happened is my customer behavior changed. There was a lot of fear to step out of house or inability to go out of houses, right? That got a spurt on e-commerce. Now, how do I go ahead and serve and the kiranas also thrived, because in fact, COVID was one revival of the kirana in India, because modern trade outlets had to shut because malls were shut, and people felt the need to go. And during first waves, there were a lot of pantry stocking that happened because people felt this as an unprecedented event. They did not know what will happen next, and hence everybody kind of stocked up months of goods together. There was a lot of pantry stocking that happened. Now, how do you change your logistical network to serve this hyper-local customer who also is going to a kirana and doing buying? They are ordering online, or there are different models that they started adopting onto. With this whole e-commerce, the expectation also set rise. Like today, I know at my own household, the expectation is you order vegetables and within half an hour, freshly made vegetables are delivered at home. So your weekend role of going and buying vegetables is gone, right? But the expectation is half an hour is the lead time, which earlier we used to only have it for pizza, and that was also 45 minutes, right? Now, but for goods also, the expectation is 30 minutes is when I should get the stock delivered. That forced us to adapt different ways and channels of serving our customers. Because e-commerce would be smaller loads, faster deliveries, much more inventory turnaround. So that put a pressure which back on logistics, where we had to customize and segment our supply chain to serve this different kind of channels. Because all of them were important to us as a CPG company. But the mix was changing, and that is where it put pressure on us. And of course, as logistics, you will always have an impending cost pressure on you. And thanks to the way diesel prices are hiking, that we had to get innovative in the way we do it, right? Like one good example from the co-panelist who was put in, like Shadowfax, right? You have multiple companies who will deliver the load to them, and they go ahead and deliver it to an Amazon or a Cloudtail or a Flipkart. So rather than us going individually in 10 different trucks, We consolidate the volume in one and send it. It becomes a win-win because they don't have to have 12 trucks for loading, unloading, and queuing outside their warehouse.
Yeah.
And I get benefits of consolidation. So a lot of companies adapted, and it kind of opened up a lot of avenues for us as logistics to curtail all those inefficiencies out. So COVID surely was a catalyst on the supply chain front.
Absolutely, Neha. I think you touched upon a very important aspect. And I think the aspect about Kirana and how they played a very important role of all of our lives in some form or other in the last, you know, several months, right, during pandemic. It is basically reinsuring that, you know, this ecosystem is here to stay. You know, by having this big e-commerce players, coming up, what would happen to Kirana? That question is answered sound, you know, beautifully sound, and they can coexist. Everyone has a market to play. And the 30-minute delivery also, I think the expectations that has been raising, you touched upon that important point. Again, one more point about, you touched about convenience. I think it looks like the customers today, when I all got used to a lot of convenience, sitting at home and getting everything done, avoiding all the traffic. I thought we all getting used to not driving to office because most of us are working from home. Unlike, lucky people like Sonia, I call lucky nowadays, because going to office is now becoming like, oh, wow, I'm missing going to office. And I'm sure a lot of people who join also would feel that I want to be in office in one day or other. So we're getting office sick. Guess what? And anybody would have thought that actually? No, right? So this is what would happen. And this is what pandemic would taught. But you mentioned Shadowfax. And let me just bring in Vaibhav in. Vaibhav, especially, you know, the business that you're operating and everything that Neha said, I'm sure you felt relevant. I would want to get a little bit of view, and I'm sure logistics and e-commerce have seen a surge of transactions. And sometimes you can't solve all the problems by putting people, and you need to handle them with smart technologies. Maybe the role of artificial intelligence and machine learning would have been big impact. And I wanted to ask you, has these technologies or any other technologies that you've used to solve this scale problem that you could share?
Sure. Good morning, everyone. And thank you so much for having us in the panel with some good folks in the industry there. So I completely agree with what Neha mentioned about the customer expectation. And similar trends is something that we are also observing when we are working with other clients as well. Coming to your question on how can different technologies help in these situations where you do not have sufficient manpower and all. So one of the key things that worked out very well for us during those periods of COVID was our serviceability API. So businesses need visibility whether we can or we cannot deliver that order. And if we can, what is the ETA by which we can deliver that order? So maybe as a consumer, you would have seen it on Big Basket, wherein they would have opened only a limited set of slots, or they have given you a token that these are the only slots that are available. Now, in order to get that data, you require strong forecasting models. So what we do here at Shadowfax, and these models can be on a day level and they can be on an intraday level as well. So at Shadowfax, what we do is that we analyze the location patterns of our delivery partners, and we identify what is the probability of getting X number of riders in a particular locality in every 30-minute duration. And using that data, we pass it on to our clients that, hey guys, this is our serviceability that is there. So you can pre-book these many set of orders on your platform. In case there is an on-demand order, we analyze the real-time location. If we have a delivery partner in the vicinity, or we forecast whether a delivery partner can come in this vicinity in the time that the order gets ready. So this technology has actually allowed a better customer experience. So, I mean, at the end of the day, if you do not have manpower, you cannot fulfill an order. I mean, at the end of the day, you require manpower, you require humans to deliver your order, to fulfill those shipments until we reach a state where drones are taking control of things. But if you, the better management of that scenario, that if I do not have a manpower, I do not have sufficient manpower, I pre-communicate the same to my clients. Clients can have similar expectations set with the customers. That ensures a much more scalable solution. That ensures a much more convenient solution from a customer standpoint. Rather than consider the opposite scenario wherein the client innovatively takes in more orders than he or us can fulfill. And as a result of it, there would be a lot of cancellations, there would be a lot of customer escalations. And so that's why it's important to have that forecasting in place, that serviceability factor in place to ensure the right setup there. So this is one of the capability or one of the product that assisted us during this COVID surge. And there was a massive surge on our platforms, and even it continues. It hasn't stopped. And as Neha rightly pointed out, the customer expectations have changed. So that is leading to all these major changes here.
Thank you, Vaibhav. I think you again relate this similar story. I think it looks like across industries, across businesses, volume being using technology. I think you mentioned about ability to forecast, and I'm sure that has changed, and that's changing rapidly, right? Earlier, we used to forecast, in the supply chain, what would you need in from a demand supply perspective when you do forecasting of demand? We could have had some trends, some algorithm to help you, but now all of them being challenged. You forecast a demand and things change, evolve in hours and days. And I'm so glad to hear that, you're using some of the technology to drive it.
Right, Katie. So just a small point, just to add on to what you mentioned. So, as we understand, logistics industry has ever since relied on forecasting to better manage its cost, to better manage its utilization percentages. Yeah. What has massively changed during this COVID is that the level of uncertainty or the level of dynamism that is needed in that forecast.
Yeah.
So you never know what regulation, you never know what kind of nuances can be presented to you the very next day. And you need to be dynamic enough to adapt to those challenges. Now, given the time frame was slightly longer, this could have been managed by a team of experts. But given the dynamic scenarios, it is now very important that you run it by your algorithms.
Yeah.
You run it by your machines.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you, Vaibhav. Sonia, I want to bring you into the conversation. And I think, especially with the business that you're operating, doesn't require any sort of, introduction, and doesn't mean any of the businesses, but you played a very important role being part of Blue Dart and managing the, customer service, for them nationally. The question that I have, do you think the choice of customers changed, especially, when you're talking about moving from a contact center calls to, let's say, a self-service, just to handle the volume and scale and also convenience? Has it been challenged even for Blue Dart?
So thanks, Katie, for this question, and thank you, Nihan, Vaibhav, for setting the pace. Katie, as we know, the COVID-19 situation actually created a new normal in most of us, in not only our work, but also our social life. And as consumers, most of us have started getting used to the click of a button and get what you want at your doorstep. So this actually brought in a growing demand to the e-com platform, like what Neha just touched upon. And we thought the sky would actually disrupt, or, because things would be work from home. How would we work from home in a contact center scenario where, you are just used to working from the office, everything is there at your office on the tip. So that was a little concern initially. But we started right from day one, Blue Dart was operational. We never had a lockdown within Blue Dart. We were operational on day one of the lockdown itself. This kind of disrupted the supply chain, no doubt, but we were prepared. Our contingency plan was in place and it worked perfectly fine for us. So we played a very critical role in connecting people, improving their lives. And during this crisis situation, the way we handled our customers seamlessly, there was absolutely no hindrance in handling our customers, and we've actually got into the to understand the pulse of our customers better, understanding the changing preferences, like the what you mentioned about voice and self-service. We could get the feel of that during this COVID period, and we did a lot of enhancements within to, you know, match the change needs of customers. Customer centricity has been the bedrock of our foundation. So, and you won't believe, Katie, if I will just pull out a number and tell you, we had the highest appreciations from our customers during the COVID period. Our NPS was at a 8+ percentage. I spoke about loyalty scores. And a lot of things that we tweak within. So if I speak about voice and self-service, there was no change at all. We had a lot of self-service options opened up for the customer, but yet customer preferred a voice, and they used to call the contact center to get a confirmation. They used the anxiety level of the customer, of course, because being high during this period, they preferred speaking to a customer or contact center advisor and getting a confirmation rather than using the app that we had given, which gave them 100% visibility of what was happening. It's the My Mobile app. Most of our customers relied on calling our contact center, so there was hardly any drop in volume, and our customer service maintained the service levels, which was promised service level of 90+. That is, within 3 rings, the calls were being answered. So, and it was seamless, whether it was on email that the customer was coming to us or on the calls, the service was seamless for us. So it had been a very good experience for us, and I think we managed it pretty well. That's what I can say about the change in the taste of customer.
Absolutely, Sonia. Now, I don't want to typecast, you know, but generally when I wanted to give a view of Indian consumer behavior to person who's outside of the country, who might not understand how our consumers behave, right? So I say, you know, Indian consumers are predominantly 2 types. One, they usually do, you know, messaging capability, the way they speak to their friends and family on a WhatsApp, so, or a social messaging channels like WhatsApp, maybe Telegram and other things, right? Or second, there's nothing in between. We straight away believe in calls. So there are only 2 ends of communication. And maybe in other countries, a lot of countries are moving away from voice-related technologies and moving towards non-voice. But my view was actually in India, voice plays a very important role. And I'm so glad to hear Blue Dot was able to maintain voice and contact center to be running during these challenging times. And again, maintaining such high customer satisfaction levels, which is noteworthy. You know, in my view, Sonia, when you delivered that high CSAT, you earned the trust of those customers. Those customers will become not only loyal, but they will start evangelizing your brand to their family and friends. When the testing times, you stayed up, helped your customers, I think, you know, you build not just loyalty, but also evangelism. Thank you for what you've done there in Blue Dot, actually, Sonia.
Thank you.
Supil, I want to bring you in this conversation with a different dimension. I think, you know, BlackBuck plays, you know, it's a marketplace. It's a tech company marketplace. You have my curiosity, actually, how do you define customers? Because I believe you have few personas that you deal with it. And what are the main challenges that you dealt with, you know, in the last few months? Probably you still kept experience in the mind when you're handling all those challenges.
Thanks, Katie. Very, very relevant one. And what, Neha, you alluded in the beginning of the call, right? GCPL, of course, being one of our important customer, all the problem which you highlighted, which happened during the pandemic, like trucks being stranded on the highways, drivers not being there, all of those we could very well relate to because we were in the midst of it. We were trying to solve all those challenges. And that gave us a lot of insight that for us, the customer is not just GCPL and all the corporate customer. We have to be equally spending a lot of time and more so on the supply partner side. And we, in the last 1 year, Kitty, taking COVID in mind, we have done a lot of steps. So let me articulate one by one for different stakeholders we have. So I would call, we have 3 major stakeholders in the entire value chain. One is the fleet owner, who is actually the owner of the truck, whose truck plies. More important than him is the driver. In Indian context, the driver and the fleet owner are 2 different entities, unlike China, where most of the owner are driver themselves. In India, a fleet owner would own on an average 2 to 3 trucks run by drivers employed by the fleet owner. So that's second biggest stakeholder for us. And the third one is, of course, shippers like Neha of GCPL and all the other marquee customers we are working with. So let me first talk about the fleet owner. A fleet owner in pandemic and pre-pandemic also used to face the biggest challenge of handling cash. They had to give loads of money to their drivers for fueling, on the highways, they have to pay tolls and a lot of sundry expenses. I think one of the important thing we have done in the last 12 months and we have been doing for the last 4 years was, how can we digitize their spend more and more rather than make them deal in cash? So we have launched, India's first ever contactless fuel card in association with oil marketing companies. So now a driver doesn't really need a physical card at the fuel station. They can just do via OTPs and get their vehicles fueled. Similarly, thanks to Indian government initiative of FASTag, where now on the highways, you don't have to pay cash. Everything has to be done through FASTag. So we have enabled more than 1 million trucks in India out of 4 million medium and heavy commercial vehicles enabled through BlackBuck FASTag. Another important thing is, as I was telling, driver and the fleet owner are two different entities. A fleet owner may be sitting in a village in Punjab, but his driver is running all across India. How can a fleet owner have much better control on where the fleet is? So we are enabling a lot of vehicles by BlackBuck provided GPS, which gives them live visibility of the truck availability, where the truck is, and so on. Those are more of what I called out was, how can we digitize their expenses better, give them better operational control. But one of the most important thing for a fleet owner is his vehicle should keep on running with loaded vehicle rather than on empty miles, because that is what is going to define his asset utilization and his earning. So in the last 1.5 years, since COVID has impacted the network imbalance so much, let's say a vehicle earlier used to go from Delhi to Mumbai and then come back from Mumbai to Delhi. Now, because of load unavailability, network imbalance, his vehicle is going all across India. And he doesn't know how to find a return load. And that's where BlackBuck plays an important role. In the last 1 year, we have developed the platform even more and more stronger with, more than 200,000 fleet owners every day finding loads on our platform, where the loads are being provided by all the marquee customer of BlackBuck, which are more than 115 numbers. In addition to that, we have opened up this platform to anybody and everybody to put up their loads. So it helps in efficient matching of a fleet owner truck with the customer requirement very, very efficiently. It helps not only cut down the empty miles, but improves the asset utilization. Just to give you a number in terms of India's, in India, a vehicle would run, say, max 7,000 to 8,000 kilometers in a month, which is running on long haul. While we are also present in Europe, a vehicle there runs more than 18,000 kilometers a month. It's 2.5 times than India, and which clearly established why the costs are so high, why India's logistic cost is 14% as against Europe of 8%. So we are trying to find, we are picking up certain problems in this industry and trying to find solutions so that efficiency of the trucks, utilization of the truck can be improved. So this is for the supplier. Now, more than supplier, the biggest and more important stakeholder is driver, because ultimately a driver has to run the vehicle, right? It won't run autonomous. Now for driver, what we have been doing in the last 1 year is, most importantly, making them safe so that they can without fear drive. So we have launched a vaccination drive where we have pulled in some of money from all the marquee customers we are working with, in addition to our investors, plus BlackBuck contributing a large chunk of it. And our goal is to ensure that more than 100,000 plus drivers who are flying on long haul, they are vaccinated so that the fear in them goes away. In addition to that, we have launched a Suraksha program for them. We are providing insurance for any accident or any exigency which happens on the way. And what Neha was telling earlier, vehicles whereabouts, how do you get to know? In India, still less than 10% of the vehicles are with GPS enabled. So we are launching GPS as a separate category and we are working to grow that. But we have launched a driver app specifically only for drivers. What that helps is, with a lot of data, a smartphone, we can find out where the driver location is. it helps not just us, but to the fleet owner, to the shippers like Neha, to know where the vehicles are, what were their last known locations. And more than location, which is track and trace, it also helps get all the digital documents, which helps customers bill their consignee faster, which helps us to know, the documents being in place. So these are some of the initiatives we are doing for drivers and we have done. And third, which is again very important stakeholder for us, customers, the end shippers like Unilever's and GCPL, there our idea is to provide them access to that platform so that vehicles can be made available as per their requirement. And more than the availability, cost also plays a very big role. Given we have access to 100,000 plus fleet owners who come and search for loads every day, our ability to find the best rates for our shippers also become important.
Yeah.
And the shipper portal being one of the last important thing where shippers can find with a click of a button, they can see, vehicle from Delhi to Mumbai has reached Indore today. Yesterday it was at this place. Tomorrow it will be at this place. So all of these features we have been able to provide to our shippers using our shipper portal. So these are some of the initiative, Katie.
Yeah, I think what is interesting, actually, I think you're creating and operating a place which is unorganized and probably, requires a place like Black Buck to come and really create a platform to bring in stakeholders to come together to exchange and to drive, to buy better logistics, across the country. Thanks for everything that you're doing. In fact, I wanted to take a pause and tell all the, participants today, we will take live questions. There are a couple of questions have already come in. I'm going to start asking those questions to the panelists. If you have a question that you would like to point me to a particular panelist, say who is the panelist that you want to ask me that question, I will do that. So, and we will take a first question from the panelists today. Shivam Lahoti is the first question that he asked. And his question is, how were the vehicles tracked before? I think, Vaibhav, when you started explaining about, the optimization and technology that you're using and stuff like that. So question was, hey, maybe GPS and all of that is helping today, but what was it before? Was there anything before at all? Except the physical, somebody calling them and say, did you see my vehicle passing?
Actually, that was the case. In case the vehicle did not reach the destination on time, there used to be a control tower team which used to call them up and understand where are you, where have you been stuck, and that's how the RCA used to be. Maybe Supel and Neha can add more on that.
Happy to add. So
absolutely, it was a call wait.
It's a call wait.
We'll call the driver and say, because we had a TAT that it reaches in 3 days or a 4 day. And that TAT was also very fluid. Now that is also becoming much more accurate and better. So you will always have a plus or minus 20% tolerance to the lead time. That has gone down significantly because now you have accurate tracking happening. But yes, the earlier way was you have 2-3 people in the control tower team will call up and say, where are you? Where did you get stuck? And that's when you will get to know.
Yeah.
So largely, as Neha and Vaibhav said, it was all manual in nature. Though one thing which evolved in last couple of years was SIM based tracking. So all the drivers would have a phone with a SIM, and with the tie up with Airtel, Vodafone and all, the ping would go to SIM and we will get the location of the vehicle via SIM based tracking. But that has the nuance is the accuracy will be far lower. Yeah. And that's where, some nuanced way like GPS and the driver app based tracking, which Black Buck has evolved into, are helping us better track the vehicle than they were before.
Brilliant. Thank you.
Kitty, if I can add to this,
please.
We also have our vehicles on the roads. And pre-COVID also, we have a live counter out here in Blue Dart, which control tower rather, which keeps a live track on the vehicle. So if the control tower tells you exactly where the vehicle is. If it's halted for beyond a certain time, it also gives you an alert saying that this vehicle has stopped for more than the given threshold time. So that creates an alert for the control tower, which is manned 24/7. So it was as normal for us because the control tower continued to operate the same way. So there was not much change, but yes, a lot of controls came in.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. And Shivam, thanks for the question. And keep those questions coming in. We will take and as the time permits and as we move into the conversation. Neha, I want to ask you this question, the next one, especially in the last, I would say, 17, 18 months, right? And we would have acted swiftly on several things. And we're calling that more of, worked pandemic, dealt with agility. And were there any such examples that you have to take some actions quickly with being agile that helped you to be where you are today?
Yes, absolutely, Prasad. I think very rightly pointed out, it called us for us to become much more agile because there was a lot of ambiguity around. Like I say that actually the supply chain became agile, more reliable and green. All three things happened. Now, how did we become much more agile? Is we started to look into the inefficiencies much more glaringly, like some of it Sibyl also said, right? Why don't you have a reverse load? So as an industry, we are saying that any vehicle, try and collaborate and give the reverse load immediately so that inefficiency kind of goes down and it brings the back down. Otherwise, there were different models that we explored because one of it was also by necessity. Like one of the example that I have is a lot of CPG companies clubbed with pizza deliveries to deliver their products to the customers, right? Now that's something that's unusual or trying to collaborate with new age companies like Dunzo to do the end delivery. So while we were doing B2B till date, but there was also B2B2C that happened because finally the customer has to get service. Because if I have distributor partners who are going to go and serve, and unfortunately COVID was very severe, and if I don't have my salesmen out in market, because we also wanted to protect them and not let them go out, the customer still has a need. How do I make sure that need is covered? So we collaborated with those who are already in market because food delivery never stopped. That was something that was under essential and we said we do it. Or some milk delivery apps that we collaborated with, right? So these are something that we could have never thought of had COVID not pushed us to think like this way. And that is also pushing companies that can you have this model coexist with your regular distributor model? That you create those dark stores in the city and hence you cut down on the lead time. If at all there is something that happens, you store at least your A category items and your lead time, which was earlier, say 24 hours or 48 hours for a service, you cut it into 3 hours flat. So any retailer who needs the stock has multiple avenues through which they buy. And that is something that has happened also before COVID with the Geomarts and Udaan of the world coming into place, because earlier the retailer only had one avenue through which they'll purchase, and that was through a distributor. But now they have multiple avenues. They can go to a cash and carry, they can order on Metro or anybody online, or they can go to another market. In fact, we've also seen some customers going to e-commerce during those sale days and stocking up and then selling it, right? So that has opened up multiple channels and it called us to become much more agile. We also evaluated different type of models. Now, only question that comes is how sustainable are those models? So did anything came out as one direct piece, which I see as getting much bigger, is of course direct to retail. The whole ecosystem is now becoming that how do you reach that last mile directly then somewhere else? Because it again is one part is also inefficiency that you see in the distribution system because your distributor will have limited vehicles, the reach would be limited. So as a distribution game, it is becoming a level playing game for all CPG companies. You all have access to all the stores. There would be a distribution partner who will go to them every day. It's about how strong are your campaigns that they are compelled to buy your product versus someone else, right? Yes. This I see as shaping up in a good way and becoming much more better. So that secondary and tertiary logistics that we used to say now is kind of becoming one. So you'll not just do secondary, but even tertiary is soon going to be part of it. We still have a way out because the distributor model is still strong. They are doing a lot and they have their own relevance in the market. But that backup model is now shaping up well. And that's something happening in the Kirana space itself. While there is OT, which is modern trade e-commerce, taking a different space, but within Kirana also, the distribution model is changing. And that's making us much more agile and quick.
Yeah, and it's the agility that you brought in which would not only help you in the last 16, 17 months, but also will help you in the months and days and years to come. Okay. Thank you, Neha. This one more question came, and probably, and I would throw this question across, see who wants to pick this up. What has been the trend of value chain transformations, which companies leverage especially after the second wave? So basically, value chain transformations that some of you would have embraced during the second wave, and what should be relevant after?
I can make an attempt, Katie, on
go
this.
Ahead. So, please.
So in the primary transportation in India, which is more than $100 billion market size annually, right? A chain is a shipper would generally get in touch with a transporter. Transporter would then get in touch with brokers. Brokers would then find a fleet owner. That's how the value chain is. Yeah. What we are seeing more and more so is this chain is not really very linear. Like entity one can also go directly to entity number four, which is the fleet owner. And similarly, entity number two can also reach out to entity number four rather than going through the linear chain. And this transformation has been, of course, because of COVID one and COVID two, but more and more so is disintermediation is really the key to bring in efficiency in this sector. Some of the initiative taken by BlackBuck, what I was just alluding before, right?
Yeah.
That app which connects directly the entity four and entity one is helping the transformation. So I'm sure this is here to stay. It's not that COVID induced it and it will die down after COVID ends. I think it is here to stay.
Yeah, so Bill, in fact, I wanted to just add from what we've seen from being in a software company, right? We felt that there was a high need to break the barriers of moving from one to another like a linear. We said, how about we bring in multiple people to come together when there is issue generally when it could be a simple delivery issue. I'm sure Sonia would be relating that in a consumer business and all of us, right? So there could be more than two parties involved in the logistics space for sure. There could be e-commerce player, there could be consumer, there's a B2B2C. I think that B in the center is evolving. So we've launched something called multi-party chart. That means you can bring in different parties together in one conversation to solve or handle a particular situation. I think that is seen a significant uptick in Indian market, especially in the growth market like India. It's so relevant. It's never been two parties dealing. Earlier, yes, it was. A consumer can only talk to business, but they never talk to suppliers. Oh, I as an OEM, I can only talk to distributors. I will not talk to consumers. I think all those barriers have been broken. And it's so good to see everything coming together to solve and providing that great CX. Talking about a CX, Sonia, I want to ask you this particular question. I'm sure lots have changed in the last 16 months from delivering great CX. Could you just talk about a few things that you've seen personally evolve humongously on delivering a great CX in the last 16 months, which is applicable to you and you in the industry?
Thanks, Katie. So great CX, yes, of course, customer expectations, it's become a conversational world. Customer can come to you through any of the channels. You still have to give the same consistent experience. So that actually has brought in a change. How do you bring it into one conversation and yet give him the same seamless experience? So that's something that we have worked upon. So digital engagements with customers have seen a great acceleration out here as well. When you talk about CX, during this pandemic situation, yes, of course, Katie, there were a lot of focus on safety and safety and hygiene factors, especially when it came to our frontline teams being out on the field and also safety of the customers. So what evolved was we were one among the first to come out with the contactless delivery because we didn't want to risk our courier, nor did we want to risk the customer whom he's going to be going and meeting and delivering some shipment. So that is something that came out. We handled secure shipments. So there was a fear, how do you deliver the secure shipment? Because there were certain protocols to deliver those shipments. That evolved the OTP system where you still have the security in place that you have delivered it to the right person and you have the track and trace of that shipment. We came out with wallets. The demonetization phase actually taught us how wallets help. And it accelerated over a period of time. So we saw how wallet-based transactions actually really got a hype now. Besides that, my mobile app, which is my convenience to the customer, customer can track his own shipment. So that actually helped and evolved even now during the pandemic phase. Besides the external customer, a lot of things were done internally as well. Internal, I mean, are for the employees. So a lot of trainings came into shape during the COVID period. We made sure each and every employee had certain protocols to be followed, which were done through internal trainings that were through digital engagement. So it was not CX only for external customer. There were a lot of internal things that happened, there were a lot of health conversations that happened through these platforms. So it was both internal and external employees, internal employees and external customers who benefited of the entire CX experience out here.
Thank you, Sonia. Really appreciate that. I know we are by the wire, but I want to get a quick soundbite from Vaibhav. Vaibhav, the future of, I'm saying, how do you see the future of customer experience evolving for logistics industry?
I think a lot is needed even in the current setup as well. So from an evolution perspective, the way we see is that there would be a more social sort of a communication that will happen with the customer. So we've seen the start of WhatsApp bots. We have seen the starts of Messenger bots as well, but they'll be more ingrained in the system. So maybe I would say in another couple of years, you would see your Alexa giving you an update that your shipment is about to be delivered. And in case you are not able to pick up your phone call when the delivery partner calls, it might be possible that your auto dialer or your Alexa device can actually share the location or can share that, drop it with the neighbor or drop it with the security guard. So, the experience per se would be more ingrained in our day-to-day sort of well-being that we'll foresee. What this would also require is a lot of investments that people like us in the logistics domain have to make in. So you need to be able to understand the conversations that are happening, extract the intent that is there, understand the tonality of the conversation as well, just to have an understanding of how smooth the conversation was or if there was certain nuances there.
Yeah.
In case of a country like India, the additional challenges on the vernacular space as well, where you have multiple languages being spoken by different people and often done in an interlooped manner. So you would have a Hindi as well as English being spoken in the same conversation. So that's some of the initial thoughts on how we'll foresee the customer experience as we move forward.
Thank you, Vaibhav. With that, I want to just summarize the conversation. It's been very insightful for me. I've learned a heaps today. I think in a summary, if I just understand, the expectations of customers are changing faster than ever. I think if you can keep the customer convenience in the center, and also having transparent conversation with customer, if there's delays, you want to tell the customer before the customer finding out. Making sure that the customer is served across not just one channel versus other. I think it's all across. You provide multiple options for customers to really engage with you. It has to be an omni-channel. And more importantly, I think the panelists said, customers want to continue to have a conversation with you. Are you really providing the tools and technology and processes to say, if the customer started a conversation, let's say on a bot, like Vaibhav said, and maybe it lands into an email and maybe it goes to a chat, and then finally somebody calls, the same customer calls, does the agent have entire interaction history to drive the conversation? Very, very important. So remember, the customer loyalty comes when you really, wow them. And the wowing by can have only happen when you don't ask the customer, can you just tell me why you're calling me? And, have you called us before for the same request and things of the nature. So keeping those in mind, I think logistics industry have seen a huge surge, and keeping CX in the center, I think there's a business growth that all of us can expect. I want to say thank you for all the patient listening, for all the participants who joined us today. You have a great rest of the day. Be safe. And I want to thank you, IMAA, for giving us this opportunity. Over to you, Mandit.
Thank you so much, everyone, for such an insightful discussion. I echo with you completely. We would like to thank our title partner, Hero Technologies, powered by partner Panda Corporation, brought to you by partner Grey Orange, supported by Logistics Skill Council, our registration partner, MapMyIndia, CX partner, Zendesk, session partner, ShipLight, silver partner, Fretron, knowledge partner, Supply Chain Labs, industry partner, PhD Chamber of Commerce and Industry. We will catch you soon once again for another exciting session. Another thank you goes out to all our attendees who were with us today. Thank you so much, everyone, and stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.